Hello students, in this video we are going to learn about ESD protection. In our previous video we learned about the clock distribution. Here we will be learning what is ESD and how to protect our circuits or the chip from this ESD. We know that the input output circuit, the clock generation unit, the distribution circuits are essential for our VLSI chip design. When I'm going to design an IC, which is VLSI chip design, when I'm doing the chip design, the input output circuitry, the clock generation, the distribution, everything is so important. So the quality of my design is important because it is related to the reliability, signal integrity, and the communication speed between the chip. If suppose I'm not properly generating my clock or I'm not distributing my circuits or the clock which has been generated, it means the design is not in a proper way and we are going to lose the signal strength, integrity and the communication speed as well. If a package is considered, okay, if a package is considered a protection layer, means I'm having a chip and the chip is having a package, I'm calling that a package is a particular protection layer. And then my input output frame will be there inside my chip, and that input output frame will be containing the input output circuits and the clock circuit, and that can be considered as a second protection layer. So how many protection layer I'm having? I'm having a two protection layer. The package is, if I'm considering my package as a protection layer, then my input output frame will act as a second protection layer. Why am I protecting all these things? Because there will be certain hazards like ESD and the noise which has to be filtered. Usually in our IC chip, we will be having certain protection layer just because we are making sure that my input output circuitry and the clock generation circuits and the distribution circuits are not damaged. Who will damage all these things is there will be a hazard called as ESD and the noise that may damage my circuitry. So that I'm having a protection layer, but still this ESD and the noise has to be filtered. So for providing a proper interchip communication, this I/O circuit must provide proper level shifting. Only then I can ensure a correct operation. Means the input output circuitry must provide a proper level shifting. So I can clamp my signal to a particular level. Only then the communication between various chips do happen. Only then it will be a correct operation. We know that ESD is nothing but electrostatic discharge. So this is an important cause of my chip failure. What is electrostatic discharge? Electrostatic discharge is a sudden flow of electricity between two electrically charged objects caused by a contact. It can be an electrical short or a dielectric breakdown. What is it? It is nothing but when a human being, suppose a person is charged and he is walking across a carpet, he will be having certain charges with him. We would have studied in our early classes rubbing with a wool or all these things. Okay, so when I'm walking on a carpet, I will be induced or I will be having certain charges. When the charged me, myself, if I go and touch any other charged objects, what is going to happen? A sudden flow of electricity do happen, and this is nothing but electrostatic discharge. So the electrostatic discharge is nothing but it is a sudden flow of electricity between two electrically charged objects. Okay, so this ESD is a prevalent cause of chip failure. ESD do occur when the charges stored in machine or human are discharged to the chip in contact or by static induction. That's what I said. What is ESD? It is important cause of my chip failure. It is due to the sudden flow of electricity. Is it okay? So now when it is going to happen, means when the charge is stored in your machine, either by in contact or by induction, that is static induction. Because of these two cases, the charge is stored in human as well as machine is going to be discharged. That is nothing but electrostatic discharge. So there are different models for my ESD testing. So I am modeling my ESD testing. So how we can do this testing? There are three different models. One is human body model. Means a human, if he walks across a carpet with, suppose it is having 80% humidity, I can induce 1.5 kilovolt of static voltage stress. Just assume a human is walking across a carpet and he induced certain charge, okay? And the touch of the charged person, I'm simulating it what I'm having a charge. Okay, this charged myself, that is charged person's finger, will be having lot of charge. If I go and touch the device, what is going to happen? ESD is happening. So what I must do, I must properly discharge the charges before it has been damaged. So how I can do all these things is, I can connect a capacitor of 100 picofarad and the charge that is stored will be discharged through a 100 picofarad capacitor through a 1.5 kilo ohm resistor. See, DUT, this is not OUT, this is DUT, which is device under test. So what is a device under test? I have to just discharge the charges, that is suppose I touched it and it has been filled with charges. Okay, so before it is becoming damaged, what I'm doing is I'm just connecting and I'm discharging the charges through a capacitor by the connection of 1.5 kilo ohm, because I'm inducing 1.5 kilovolt of static voltage stress, and because of that I'm discharging with the help of a 100 picofarad capacitor. What I must do is, we must, though we have the CSD testing, we must have certain protection networks that must be designed into the IO circuitry. So the protection networks are designed into the IO circuits, only then the ESD can be filtered. So ESD is nothing but it is a cause of the chip failure, and it will happen when two charged particles or the bodies touch each other. Because of that, there will be certain discharge, and to avoid the discharge, I am using a capacitor and we are discharging the already charged charges. Okay, now there is not only a human touching a particular object, it can happen by contact with other machines also. So the ESD can happen by contact with other machine, but this time the stress will be even more. See, when a human touches itself, there will be certain charges. What if a machine, it will be a metal, there will be a lot of charges and there will be a lot of ESD do happen when some other machine comes in contact with our chip. So I am discharging that and I am simulating that with the help of a 200 picofarad. So the charged device will be discharging through a 200 picofarad capacitor. And another model is called as the charged device model. See, it can happen when a person or some other machine touch that particular IC, but still even the IC itself can discharge. It may happen during the chip assembly. What may happen is the charges may get accumulated. When the charges may get accumulated, again there will be an ESD that do happen inside the chip itself. So the charge device model ESD testers are used for electrically charging the device under test. And I'm using a probe, okay, that is a discharging probe, and I'm testing on the device under test. What is the device I want to test? I'm just keeping the probe on it for what? For electrically charging the device under test and just discharge it to the ground. So whatever charged, suppose this is a charging display, if I have the switch is connected, so this device under test, whatever the charge is present and the device will be discharged by using a discharging probe. Previously, because of a human finger, that ESD happened, and again through the help of another machine, the ESD do happen. The ESD may happen in the device itself. So I can just provide a charging supply. The device is being charged with various lot of charges that may spoil my device. So I can use a discharging probe which can electrically charge my device and it discharges it to ground. These are the various ESD models, and protection networks must be connected. As I said, it must be connected into your IO circuits. So one of the circuit that I can go for protecting my IO circuits are nothing but a diffused resistor and a diode structure. The input resistor I am using here is 1 to 3 kilo ohm, and the input resistance in the capacitance, what it is going to do, because I said that it is a protection network, so the input resistance and the capacitance are going to clamp my voltage to a safe level. So this clamping is done with the help of my diode. But still, what is going to happen? We can't just like that increase or clamp your voltage to a particular level, because the diode current may spoil my device, because we do know that in your diodes, we have certain breakdown. So what I can go for is the diode current has to be limited. So in the place of that, I can go for a polysilicon resistor. But still, there is some dielectric breakdown that do happen if I use a polysilicon resistor. for limiting my current. When we used a diode, we had some limitation in the current. So we went for using a polysilicon resistor. But even in that case, there was a dielectric breakdown. We know that there will be certain dielectric, which is SiO2, which is a dielectric oxide. So this dielectric may cause a breakdown, which is called as a dielectric breakdown. And for overcoming that, we are using a thick oxide MOSFETs. Along with your resistance, I am using a thick oxide MOSFETs. These are M1, M2, M3. This is nothing but a protection circuitry. So this circuitry will be used before my input-output circuitry such that there is no ESD, there is no electrostatic charge distribution. The electrostatic charge discharge will not happen if I connect a certain N MOSFETs in series with along with my resistance and with the diode. So these are the protection network that is not going to spoil my device or my circuit by clamping my voltage to a particular level. So this is all about my ESD protection. I hope you understood the video, and in the next video, we shall see about input circuits.